Hello, my name is Margaret Bagshaw. While I am of Native heritage, that fact alone in no way defines my art. I am a modernist painter. However, never has the quote you just read been more relevant than now. When I was asked to put on a show for the Ellen Noel Museum in Odessa, Texas, the first thing that came to mind was oil. As a colorist and an oil painter, my next thought was, what color is oil? Then I put the two together and voila. A title was born, The Color of Oil. Someone once said to me that your mother and grandmother painted to escape. I can't think of a better way to escape. I hope you enjoy the next 30 minutes as I walk you through the 25 large paintings that make up this show. Since oil is a primary fuel and a primary driving force for our economy, I felt the title painting needed to be painted in primary colors. Can you see the references to oil in the painting? How about the fossil fuel concepts? Check out the dinosaur head on the derrick on the left. This next group of paintings are the 10 chapter paintings from my book, Teaching My Spirit to Fly. Maxed Out was started with two asymmetrical circles. I wanted to begin with random shapes and see where it took me. There are times when people say, "You look like you are a million miles away." And in this painting, I really was. I was in another world. I was on an adventure. I went through space. And using simple shapes and simple colors and playing with the values and with my hands, and not being worried about filling in the perfect line, or creating balance, or creating anything that was finite or polished, or perfect, and it just turned into this other place. I referenced an artist that was a childhood hero of mine, Peter Max. When I was painting this, I thought about how his paintings and his design made me feel as a young child. When I was 7 or 8 years old, his art made me feel completely free and uninhibited, and I felt that as a 45-year-old when I painted this. Repercussions of a Solar Storm, coincidentally or not, was finished the day before the big breaking news item was about an impending solar storm. This also is the painting for the chapter in my book where I met my soon-to-be husband Dan for the first time. This painting is a very good example of my cubist style. Blocks laid over blocks, laid over layers, laid over shapes, laid over color, with parallel lines and arbitrary lines. Live Together, Love Together, Pray Together is a very romantic piece. I did this for those spirits that belong together. Those soulmates that belong together forever and eternally. Again, this is a good example of my cubist style, using another color palette and another format, using a different composition of beings rather than random abstract spatial composition. La Papesa is the story of Pope Joan. In 840 AD, as a child, Joan took her brother John's identity after he was killed during a Viking raid on the monastery school they both attended. Joan grew up in her brother's identity and became a physician on the streets of Rome. After attracting the attention of the Pope and becoming his physician, Joan, as John, was named successor after the Pope's death. Her true identity was discovered when she died giving childbirth on Easter Sunday. If you look at the painting, you can see her face. You can see her tears running down her face. She is very sad because she can't be her true self. In this painting, I used crosses and scroll work to depict the Catholic Church. This scroll work is seen in the gates and the fences often surrounding churches and holy ground. The crosses need no explanation. I also tried to evoke the idea of stained glass. I wanted to create the feeling of being inside Joan's Catholic Church. Birth of a Mystic is another one of my self-portrait paintings. This painting represents me in my own world and shows my perception of my own internal spirit and my external spirit. My internal spirit is portrayed through the chakras, and my external spirit is portrayed with three different cultural symbols by way of the different orbs that surround her. They are Mexican, Celtic, and Native imagery. The pyramid that she is sitting in and around is indicative of my own very ancient past. You will see on her right side she is sitting in a sea of flames. To her left is a sea of blood. Down below her is a pool of water. This could be water that has broken from her birth. Her hands hold the energy of blood in one hand and the energy of fire and healing in the other. The spiral that is around her is the spiral of life. This brings her forward into time and takes her backward into time. Internal Metronome is another abstract painting that began with a composition of intuitive lines and shapes. This filled my absolute need for peace and tranquility and revitalization during the painting of this series. When I am doing a group of paintings or spending all of my time painting, I get to a point where I need to recharge. At this point in this series, the halfway mark, I was running low on energy, and this painting started the flames again and got me back on track. I often have these recharging or reinvigorating paintings. They come out of nowhere, and they often are different than a lot of the paintings surrounding them. The name of this painting relates to getting back my timing and rhythm again. Subconscious is another self-portrait painting. This painting completely came from someplace else, literally, in another time in my life. I had learned how to scuba dive while in the Virgin Islands from 2006 to 2009. And having fun with that and exploring the world underwater, I found someone I could identify with as me and someone I could have fun with. And that was the archetype mermaid. She was a playful spirit and a part of me that I had not encountered or spent time with in a very long while. This became my new world, the Caribbean, where I felt that I belonged and the ocean was a very beautiful place and opened my world to new animals and a new color palette and a whole new perspective on looking at life. This period opened my world to a new me and I loved every part of it. Unintended Consequences was painted in a very playful, almost irresponsible mood. You can see a lot of identifiable shapes, and then it also has very random abstract shapes. The color palette is a little tropical and a lot of fun. There's cubism and abstract. It truly is the unintended consequences of what happens when you play too hard and just go for it. The Rain Council is another in a series of rain paintings that I started doing in about 2003 when we were going through one of our drought seasons. And sure enough, when I finished it, we started getting rain. The Rain Council started out with a layer of gray paint. Once I had that spread over the canvas, I took a squirt bottle of turpentine and sprayed the canvas and I let the paint run. Normally, I don't like wet, drippy paintings, but in this case, I felt that it was extremely appropriate. The next thing I had to do was introduce color. So in the order of the rainbow of color, I started with the heat and hots in the red on the left side. I then moved into the yellows and greens and blues and indigo and violet. Each spirit figure represents some form of a recipient of the rain. There is fire or heat or dryness that results from not enough moisture or rain. Moving into the growth, the corn or the figures that have the corn. Moving into the green, representing all the growth benefiting from the rain. Then moving from the green into the blue or water that represents the waters, the rivers, and the lakes that benefit from the rain. If you look up into the sky in the painting, you will see the Avanyu. The Avanyu, or serpent, is responsible for bringing us the rain or water. Here, I put the Avanyu in the form of lightning at the top, because lightning is usually accompanied by rain. The lightning is also the great call that we need rain. And then I put rain on top of the entire painting as silver splatters. Splatters is not something I normally do in my paintings either. But again, in this case, it was appropriate. Water Signs was painted in several ways, in several layers, and is actually several paintings. The Avanyu, or the water serpent, is very important in the Pueblo culture. This is the deity that is responsible for bringing all forms of water, both sky water, or rain, and earth water. On the Santa Clara black-on-black pottery, you will often see the Avanyu wrapped around the pots or vessels. The Avanyu has a great deal of importance and is held in very high regard. To me, when I painted water signs, the Avanyu was very important in several respects. First, we were in the middle of one of our infamous New Mexico droughts. Second, the painting was an introspective way of viewing the world. I think when we view the world, we need to look at ourselves. The painting has the eggs that represent the eggs of the serpent, but also represent the continuance of the world. This is a very powerful and centered piece. This is also a good universal representation of the many cultures that use the serpent image, the dragons, the snakes, and the crocodile. From Asian, Mexican, Celtic, Native American, African, this basic image concept is a part of many, many cultures around the world. The reason I called it water signs is because I am a water sign. I initially began the Motherline series as an homage to my mother and grandmother. As the series developed, it became apparent that it should include other strong women from different cultures who have made a difference in society. Messages and Miracles was the first painting in the Motherline series. At the time, in 2010, it was the largest painting I had done. It is 5 feet by 8 feet. I use 3 figures that are representative of my grandmother, my mother, and myself. However, none of the figures in this painting are specifically any one of us. The outlines for the 3 images are based on my mother's robes figures, but just the outline shapes. The compositions and activities in and around all 3 figures is purely my own language. In the background, you will see 2 worlds colliding, the old and the new. This is representative of the creative journey from my grandmother to my mother to me. Several spirit figures can be seen delivering the messages or paintings throughout the canvas. When I started painting this very large work, I found that I could truly become a part of my painting and experience another world, where I could talk to myself or my mother or my grandmother. This became a place where I could think about past or current situations or conversations that I had or would have. Keeping something safe is about the legacy that we are all given and the importance of taking care of that legacy and keeping it safe. In this painting, there are guardians and faces. It's as though they are protecting the gates of something sacred. I felt that they were strong overseers, and their significance and strength helped this painting to become a strong and significant piece. This is very cubist and very multi-layered, and there is a lot of underpainting and that helps to create the warm and peaceful feeling in this work. This is a perfect example of how I work compositionally as opposed to creating a recognizable image or subject. Each of these small sections are a composed and balanced painting on their own. This painting is part of the permanent collection at the Museum of Indian Arts and Culture in Santa Fe. The irony that this painting lives at the museum has never escaped me. The painting title implies the obligation of the museum to keep safe and protect the legacies of the artists in the museum. Ancestral Procession is, up until now, the most monumental painting that I have done. It is almost 7 feet by 10 feet. As the title says, this is a procession of ancestors. It is composed with a very abstract and random background. The images that come out of that are identifiable as spirits or beings or kachinas. These figures hold the presence of the past and the presence of the future. Within each of them are repeated symbols and patterns that are specifically from my mother's style or my grandmother's style. Two of the figures represent my grandmother's personality, and two of them are my mother's personality. I am in the middle. For instance, the tabletas on the head come from my grandmother, and the abstract contemporary headdresses are from my mother. The wild child in the middle, the warrior goddess, with the turquoise breastplate, it's all me. The earrings shown are all earrings that my mother left me and that I regularly wear. This is an extremely personal painting. I am called Mother Earth is the ultimate reference to Mother Earth. The keeper of all things sacred and natural in this world, she who connects the sky to the earth, she who grows our food, and she who provides sustenance to all that is, the Corn Mother. Alchemy of Destiny contains three masks that represent the three of us. These masks and other images contain references to the ancient and modern contemporary. The title pretty much says it all. It references the alchemy that is the magic of my destiny. Since I am a part of this legacy and lineage, the images reflect the strength and wonder of my family legacy. The bold, strong colors and abstract designs are very much my style. They are layered down over top of ancient-looking designs that represent my ancestors. Even with the random shapes, you can see the spirits that guide and help me on my journey. The finish on this painting is very unique for my work. Women's World started with three of my mother's robes designs. When I use three, it usually represents my grandmother, my mother, and myself. In this particular painting, I wanted it to be very subdued so I could use very earthy colors. That is what led into very traditional images of Native women and their creativity, and their traditional crafts or their fine art forms. The facial images are direct references to the three of us. My mother's image is represented by something very similar to her medicine or changing woman image. My grandmother's image is represented by the aged, ancient, torn design. The most abstract, non-representational design depicts me. This painting includes a number of images that represent the various art forms or work done by Native women. Pottery designs, weaving or textile designs, basket designs, and painting as shown by the overall painting itself. Between Two Worlds is a self-portrait image that shows a figure that is part of two distinct lives. Perhaps my spirit in this world and the next world, or the native world, or the white world, or the artist, or the business world, or your world and my world. It's that torn between place of where am I and where do I belong. I painted Hatshepsut for several reasons. Her story was similar to that of my mother's and my grandmother's, women who had made an impact on society and then were ostracized. Hatshepsut's successor ordered that all evidence of this lady pharaoh be erased. This painting follows a strong female theme that has been showing up in many of my paintings over the last few years. The background composition includes strategically placed circles with the pharaoh in the largest one. I told her story with hieroglyphs. Clockwise from the top right is the traditional Eye of Horus. Hathor is up behind Horus. In a complicated relationship, Hathor is at times the mother, daughter, and wife of Ra, as Isis is sometimes described as the mother of Horus. Of course, I had to put the pyramids in because, well, it's Egypt. Here she is portrayed as the queen married to King Thutmose II and before she became pharaoh. Next to that, smaller, is her portrayed as pharaoh with Thutmose III offering wine to Amun. Here, Osiris, Isis, and Horus show the things that were important to Hatshepsut. At the bottom are the wings of Isis from a lintel of Hatshepsut and Thutmose III. This has a structural purpose, elevating her temple, which supports her nomen as pharaoh. The two large figures standing at the left and right are Osirian statues of Hatshepsut in front of her temple at Luxor. This is a rendering of Senenmut, thought to be her lover. On the left is Thutmose III, with Hatshepsut looking away. She was known for her architectural accomplishments, including the largest ever built obelisk. This was toppled by her successor, Thutmose III. She is portrayed traditionally as the pharaoh hawk. As a child, I was crazy about Egyptian culture. My first exposure was checking out a book at the school library about Egyptian mythology. To me, it was important to place her with points of light hovering around her to deliver the message of her higher presence. In October, I was fortunate enough to see an exhibit at the Brooklyn Fine Art Museum that included this period bust of Hatshepsut. She still had a lot to say. Clans of the Old World is a complicated painting. It is not necessarily something that you would instantly recognize as a Margaret Bagshaw abstract or cubist painting. This is a Celtic calendar with masks as moon phases. This is more of a cross-cultural reference that I intentionally did based on the parallel vision that I saw from my grandmother's lineage and my Anglo ancestors, as well as my husband's Celtic ancestors. It is a reference to the similarity between those two cultures with regard to rituals, myths, and legends, including seasons, harvests, pagan rituals, and everyday life. Both of the cultures from opposite ends of the world went through at about the same time in their migration and life after the Ice Age. Timeline was done as a result of my participation with the National Geographic Genome Project. Good friends of ours sent us DNA sample kits as a fun experiment, to see where mine and Dan's backgrounds may have crossed paths. When I got my results back and saw the path that my ancestors had taken, this painting came about very naturally, almost on its own, obviously originating in Africa, through the Middle East, up into Europe, into China, and across the Bering Strait landmass. This is another of my multicultural paintings covering a number of cultures and origins. In the background, behind the painting in the video, you can see the actual results from National Geographic from my DNA sample. The figures on each end look somewhat African, representing all of our beginning. Collecting My Thoughts is another meditative, gentle painting. If you look at all of the bright, colorful paintings from 2013, you may wonder how this simple three-color painting came about. Well, when I'm painting for long stretches for a show, I get very tired and fatigued. I need to rest my mind as well as my physical body. I need to sit and collect my thoughts. That is what this simple three-color painting was. This was a regrouping. In quiet, relaxed, soft colors. This is a simple, uncomplicated piece that is me relaxing and just letting things go. It is a meditative, tranquil painting and sets me up to move back into complex, compositional, storytelling paintings. Often I will use minimal color palette as a way of clearing my mind. Here I used two shades of gray and an olive green. All of the color variation is a result of layering thin, translucent layers. Red Red Wine is the exact opposite of Collecting My Thoughts. This was a fun painting for me to do. It is a super high energy, very festive, and extremely cubist piece with lots of line work. It was meant to be very enthusiastic and energetic. It's a play on words from the UB40 song Red Red Wine. And my, I want to get busy and paint wine. Red is a very good color to get me to start moving again. This was a great place for me to go after painting, Collecting My Thoughts. Spinning in Four Directions is sort of a humorous piece. Being in the art business, being in the gallery business, and being in the mommy business, sometimes I go into overload and feel that I'm being pulled in many different directions. This is a seasonal circular piece depicting me trying to find my center. The spiral goes in or out. This is a playful, expressive theme for me. And then I saw you standing next to me. Beckoning of the Plumed Serpent was started as we were about to go into a hot, humid summer. On May 28th, our fire season started. My paintings can sometimes be a prayer, and painting is very meditative. In this case, this was another call for the rain that we so desperately needed. As I have said earlier, in many cultures, the plume serpent, or Avanyu, is the bringer of rain. So the Avanyu is what I paint at times like this. The serpent here is very bold and very strong. And the result was that our past September was one of the wettest on record. In fact, I had a number of clients and friends calling the gallery to ask me to cover the painting up for a while so they could dry out. Humorously, I would like to think that this painting had something to do with that. It was great.
Come and listen to the sound. never be the same. Take time and listen, and don't focus on the pain. And I hear you. I hear you. That best depicts my life. And draw me an ocean I can't sail left to life. Throw me an anchor and I'll wait it out till morn. I'll leave tomorrow, come hell or high red dawn. And I hear you. And I hear you.
Three important women, three important artists, three important stories. Historically, they represent the only documented three-generational full-time professional female painting dynasty. One opened the door, one changed things forever, and one took native art to the mainstream art world. Pablita Velarde, In Her Own Words, by Dr. Shelby Tisdale, Director of the Museum of Indian Arts and Culture. Helen Hardin, A Straight Line Curved, by prominent New Mexico writer Kate Nelson. And Margaret Bagshaw's memoirs, Teaching My Spirit to Fly. For more information or to order your books, please call 505-988-2024 or visit us on the web at www.thethreebooks.com.